As we begin our final new episode of the year, which will also be the final episode of Season 3, Something's Happening Here is taking a look at the usual suspects of Bible prophecy to see what the spiritual world is up to at the end of 2023. We start today with an eye toward globalism. What is this boogeyman concept? Is it real? What does it look like? And how does prophecy inform us in this discussion? We will see some surprising, or perhaps not so surprising, relationships between the concept of globalism and several other dominant ideologies in the world today. I'm Steve Hicks, Director of Podcast Ministries for Talking Donkey International. Thanks for starting your week with us as we look at the ism family today. All right, friends, happy Monday, if there is such a thing. As I mentioned in the opener, this is the last episode of 2023, and it will be the last episode of Season 3 of our show as well. So when we return in January, it will be the premiere of Season number 4. Thank you for joining us. This has been a wild ride for those of us here at Talking Donkey International. At least for me, this whole experience has been quite a bit different than I anticipated it being from the very beginning. But ultimately, the experience would not be the same without you watching, because otherwise it's just, you know, those of us here just talking to ourselves. So thank you so much for taking your time out of today and every day that you choose to join us. And I pray that when the show is over, you're not going to remember me so much, nor my producer, nor anything else about the show, but that which will stay on your mind forever would be Jesus Christ, because he is the only reason we're actually doing this in the first place. And since it's the giving season, right, it's the Christmas season, I'm going to talk a little bit more about this on Thursday, but I would like to petition you to support our show. There's a couple different ways you can do that. The one that is the most fun for me is if you go and join our channel on locals.com, somethingshappeninghere.locals.com. You can do that for free. That doesn't actually help the show financially, but that does have an option for you to become a paid supporter. And the benefit for you for doing that is that there's extra things that I put on that channel weekly or weekly thereabouts that you're not going to find anywhere else, like literally anywhere else. It's the only place that I put those extra studies or extra insights or whatever we're doing. So for as little as $5 a month, though you can certainly donate as much as you want to, but for as little as that amount per month, you can really help us out considerably and also get extra things for your own study and edification. I'll talk to the producer if we have a direct link for donations to Talking Donkey. We'll get that to you as well. But I'm appealing to you because this show is not free. And we have been not recovering the amount that we put into it from the beginning. So if you like what we do and you believe it's important in the world, and I certainly do believe it's important in the world, please consider helping us out. Just pray about it. And if the Lord directs you to help us, please say yes. On to the show. Our show this week is on the concept of globalism. And we're going to take a bit of a jigsaw puzzle approach to it, where every day is not going to seem like it's connected to the day before or the day following. But by the end of the week, hopefully we have painted a complete enough picture that you're going to understand where I'm coming from in this regard. But since it is the beginning of the week, we have to start by defining what we mean when we use the word globalism or globalist. So our article for today is not even an article, but it comes from Quora.com, which is like Reddit. It's one of these idea sharing kind of chat room forums. And this particular one is from a person who asked the question, what is the globalist agenda and how will it impact humanity in the near future? Now, this is several years old, as you're going to see. And the answer that I'm going to read from is at least 4 years old. So you'll see the current events in the answer are a little bit off. But I'm reading, I want you to read the whole thing. There's a link in the show notes. It's a long answer. I'm only going to read a portion of it, but you should read the whole thing. when you go to this link, there are many, many answers. And I'm reading from the second one down from the top, at least as it appears at the time that we're recording. The answerer's name is John Hudson. I assume that's a real name, but it's at least his name he uses online. And he has an answer. What is the globalist agenda and how will it impact humanity in the near future? I thought this was a really good answer. And let's just get to it. I don't want to put words in his mouth. His answer is, the detail level of answer to a question like this is very long and detailed. Da-da-da. So to keep it shorter, I will just deal with a big picture view. At the big picture level, the globalist agenda has not changed. A true globalist works for the day when humanity has one language, one currency, one government, one military, one set of global laws, and where one can be a citizen of the world. I wonder why we even need a military, really, if we're all like one great big happy human family, but okay, all right, fair enough. Mr. Hudson continues. These are the major characteristics of humanity becoming a truly united global species and society. It has a lot, capital L-O-T, of real advantages. Such a global society can effectively cooperate to take effective action against things such as global warming, habitat destruction, such as the Amazon rainforest, fires and other destructions, pollution, organized crime, and disease, including plagues and pandemic diseases. Now, isn't that a prophetic answer? 4 years ago means he wrote this before COVID happened. So this guy is, he's got his fingers on some sort of pulse. He continues, with only one military, wars between nations no longer occur, reducing military expenditures by 90% and refugees, et cetera, et cetera. In 1900, the human population was around 1 billion. Most transport and communication was by sailing ships, some steamships, railways, and horse-drawn transport. Governance was by nation-states cooperating through ambassadors and embassies. Two world wars, hundreds of other wars, a plague, by now it's now two plagues, environmental slash biosphere destruction, and the loss of hundreds of thousands of species suggest the nation-state governance system wasn't hugely successful or adequate. We now live in a world approaching 8 billion people. Transport is by plane, train, and container vessels. Communication is by radio and internet. Global governance is still by nation states cooperating through embassies and ambassadors. In a world that is now at least 1,000 times faster, more knowledgeable, and more complex than in 1900, international governance processes and structures are perhaps just 5 to 10 times improved, perhaps not even that much. It really hasn't a hope. To try and prevent World War III, which with nuclear winter really could be the war to end all wars, we now have the United Nations and some things like the European Economic Community. We have seen empires, including the Soviet Union, come and go. And I'm just going to stop there for the sake of time. But again, you read the whole thing because I'm not a globalist, and I wish that this man was wrong in the things that he was writing, but nonetheless, he's not wrong. This is a pretty good picture of a globalist's idea. So that's what we're talking about today. It's this idea that is not just a small modification on the way things are, but a complete revolution of how things are, right? So it's no longer you will not be a citizen of the United States or wherever you happen to be watching this. You'll be a citizen of Earth, as we all will. And again, I mentioned this before, but if everyone is a citizen of Earth, why do you need a military at all? It just seems like you would need local police forces to deal with, you know, with errant criminals, right? But you wouldn't need a military because there are no other nation states against which you have to go to war. It might be civil war, but I don't want to go down that rabbit hole because this is a utopia. And this is the point that I want to bring out today. If you have been following along, like I'm recording this at the end of 2023, which means if you're watching this and you're an American, you have lived through the Biden administration for 3 years now, just about. And if you've been following along with the trajectory of the Democratic Party and the Biden administration specifically, or if you're a resident of California for the last 20 years or so, then you will see a whole lot of overlap between what Mr. Hudson wrote on Quora.com here and what comes out of the mouths of these politicians. I'm going to suggest to you that globalism is really just socialism. They're the exact same animal. It's just, I think socialism is approaching it from like a, how do we change the existing state of things? You know, how do I modify this government to be more socialist? Whereas globalism is kind of the end result of all the little socialisms put together. That's how I see it. And regardless of how you choose to kind of parse out the definitions, it's unmistakable that their goals, their kind of macro big picture goals, are identical. And so the reason that we, for example, have a wide open southern border with Mexico right now, through which a whole lot more than just Mexicans are coming, but we have people from all over the world flooding into the United States through that border by the hundreds of thousands, by the millions, if you take a large enough time period. The reason that's happening is ultimately because the people who are allowing it to happen don't believe there should be borders, don't believe there should be nation states. We're all one human family, so come on in. What's mine is yours. It's like these people watched the end of the movie Black Panther and said, that's a great idea. Now, if you've seen the movie, you know what I'm talking about. I personally think Black Panther is a really good movie with a really stupid ending. In short, the Wakandians have access to this like out of this world, amazing technology, but up to that point, they have held it onto themselves in like a secret little kingdom in the middle of Africa somewhere. But because of the events of the movie, they are now convinced that they need to share this great technology with the entire world because they're all one global family or something like that. So it was a really good movie right up until the end when I realized it was actually just socialist claptrap. My point is like, these are the ideas that the Democrats, the liberals, the globalists, like whatever label you want to put on these people, this is how they think. The old way of I'm an American, you're something else is not how they think. They're really striving for a world without borders, without war, without different currencies, without differences of government and whatnot. If you've been watching this show for any amount of time, you know that I spend a lot of time in Daniel chapter 11, and you know why. It's because in Daniel 11, we have these two major characters, the king of the north and the king of the south. They represent ideologies that have been present in the world for millennia now, but are still present in the world. They've taken a few different kind of outward forms, but the ideology underneath those forms is always the same. And one of those ideologies, specifically the king of the south, represents all of the isms, the ism family, so to speak. Everything that is left over after you remove God from the equation. So that's humanism, socialism, communism, globalism, naturalism, right? All of those things that are designed to describe or improve the world around us through ideas, right? Or the implementation of ideas that are different than what is being implemented and acted upon right now. So when we look at the state of things, when we look at this globalist manifesto, so to speak, from Mr. Hudson on Quora.com, and we compare it against Daniel 11, verse 40, which is that final showdown between the king of the north and the king of the south, we recognize that that is where we are in time. The scripture says, at the time of the end, the king of the south shall attack him, being the king of the north, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind, etc. And this counterattack from the king of the north is so devastatingly successful that it wipes the king of the south off planet Earth. It's just not represented in the prophecy anymore. And the king of the north and its ideology remains dominant until Jesus comes. What we have to recognize about the king of the south then is that this final onslaught from the king of the south must be different than all of the previous iterations of this warfare throughout time, right? Because the king of the South has attacked in the past, but it has not elicited a response from the king of the North that is as devastating as this one here in verse 40. So we're looking for not just yet another manifestation of the ism family. We're looking for like the moment in time when the ism family wants to take over. It wants to be the dominant force. It doesn't have any time for you anymore. And if you just look at American society for the last 5 years, maybe, you know, from the beginning of the Trump administration, where these rumblings happened, and then once the Democrats got power in 2018, that's when it really, really took off, and it has not subsided yet, where it seems like every single day President Biden has got some new globalist idea that he wants to inflict upon the rest of us. This seems to me like a really heavy assault by the King of the South. And now we have this specter of President Trump becoming president again, and he's not going to be a dictator except on day one. And we've got all the Republican, or a lot of the Republicans, saying we need to be a Christian nationalist society. And, you know, this language of taking a country back, restoring this. Again, when you match it up against the prophecy here, it seems like the King of the North is just waiting for its chance. Right, it has had enough of being stepped on, and it is going to take over as soon as it possibly can. So that's where I think we are. And since we're out of time already again, I'll take us quickly to Revelation chapter 13. And the first few verses there tell us pretty plainly that this power at the end of time that Revelation calls Babylon, or Daniel called the King of the North, this power at the end of time is not a single power. It's not like one nation by itself, or one church system by itself, or one group by itself. This beast, this power at the end of time, is described as having, here in Revelation 13, verse 1, seven heads and 10 horns, and on his horns, 10 crowns, and on his heads, a blasphemous name. And then down in verse 3, we learn that all of the world marveled and followed the beast. And in verse 4, we realize one of the reasons why it marvels at the beast is because it's so powerful that no one can war against it. So we put all that data together, and this is a multifaceted entity, right? It's a lot of individual entities partnering together into one whole beast with seven heads, right? Well, that's globalism. Right? That's exactly what Mr. Hudson told us in Quora.com. This is the idea where the individual nation states don't exist anymore because we've all come together into one conglomerate nation that rules over everything and everybody. So in other words, Revelation stands as prophetic evidence that globalism's going to win, which is not to say that it's good. Because it's not. I mean, it will bring horror into the world, and it will elicit the return of Jesus Christ. I mean, it will prompt Jesus to come back from heaven to put an end to the whole thing, and restore it, and to bring his kingdom to the earth, right? So it's not going to be good. It also helps us to understand that it's the King of the North that's dominant at the end. And yet it's globalist anyway. So I'm laying the globalism and all the isms at the feet of the King of the South. But I have said many times in previous studies of that same chapter on the show that really the King of the North and the South are just two sides of the same coin. They look very different in the way that they manifest on earth, but they're not really. They're both just manifestations of the devil. And the only safe place to be is not with the Democrats, and it's not with the Republicans, it's not with the conservatives, it's not with the liberals, it's not with the globalists, it's not with the federalists, okay? The only safe place to be in these days is with Jesus Christ, all the way back in verse 22, hanging on the tree, dying in righteousness, because this is not our home, waiting for the kingdom of God, which is our home. So that's our setup for the week. Globalism is on the march. I noticed that Mr. Hudson mentioned the United Nations. The United Nations, which has been really a joke since its beginning, but which is making sure we understand what a joke it is by pretending that it has any regard for Israel at all while it calls for ceasefires in the war that's going on there. I don't know if you're paying any attention to that, but that was just a couple days ago. They had this resolution that the United States objected to, but passed anyway, calling for a ceasefire there. Well, I mean, of course, I don't want the war to continue either, but when you cease your fire against someone who has stated its only desire is to destroy you, then all you're really doing is accepting that fate. You're saying like, okay, fine, destroy me. And the United Nations is not actually out for the survival interest of all of its members, clearly, or else it would not be doing this. The United Nations is a joke. The European Union is a joke. When Mr. Hudson wrote his answer, the Brexit had just happened. But you and I, as I record this, are living with years of experience of the Brexit phenomenon. And we know that Europe hasn't really gotten any better. The whole thing almost went bankrupt right around when Britain exited. But even today, it's not in a very strong position economically. And what I hear out of Europe is all from the globalists there. It's not even from the European Union, so to speak. I hear a lot more from like the monetary people and these kind of globalist people more than any individual nation state or even the European Union. So my point is that these institutions that we're holding up as great globalist examples of how good things can be are actually ineffective and kind of racist and are doing just as much damage in the world as those that they are supposed to prevent from doing damage in the world. So globalism is everywhere. It is on the march. It's not going anywhere anytime soon. I'm sorry to all my Republican friends. I sympathize with you. I wish the world could be a little bit smaller, where people could kind of govern their own selves in a state of freedom. But that's just not prophetically where we're going. So we need to always be with Jesus, make sure that we're safe, and ultimately that we can go home to his kingdom where we're not going to have any of these problems anymore. Let's pray. Lord God, give us wisdom as we are embarking on this globalist journey this week. Give us wisdom to see right from wrong and what is true and what is not, and to ultimately discern godliness above all things. Even as we discuss things that are contrary to God, we know that all things ultimately come from or point to you. They are allowed by you, even if they are negative, because you are omnipotent. There is nothing that you don't have authority over. So give us wisdom, Lord, to navigate this the right way and to see clearly our way to Jesus and through Jesus, our way to your kingdom. Forgive our sins, Father. Amen. And your job in the meantime is to go to tdimedia.org to bookmark that page. And from there, you can link to any of our social media presences and subscribe to whichever one you like, or subscribe to them all, right? Your subscription helps us no matter where it is. And again, as I mentioned earlier, if you become a paid supporter on locals.com, that helps us the most in a direct way in terms of being a member of social media. So God bless you. Come on back tomorrow. We're going to continue our globalist discussion, but we're going to be a little more specific tomorrow. So I will see you then. Get a great night's sleep and come on back tomorrow.